Welcome, welcome, welcome. Hi, everyone. Good evening. Good evening. Welcome to Mechanics Institute for our very special storytelling showcase this month with Corey Rosen and Backfence PDX. I'm very excited to welcome you all to Mechanics Institute. Who is here for the very first time? Wow, look at those kids. Awesome, welcome. For those of you who are here for the first time, we're very excited to have you come. And for those who are returners, welcome back. Mechanics Institute was founded in 1854, so a very old nonprofit here in San Francisco. We are a cultural center, historical landmark, multi-story, gorgeous, general interest library, world-renowned chess program. We're the oldest chess club in the United States. And we are an events center, like what we're doing this evening. We have anywhere from 5 to 15 events per week here at Mechanics Institute. We are a hub for writers, readers, cinephiles, chess players, creators, and everything in between. There's something for everyone here at Mechanics Institute, and I hope you'll come back and join us for another event. Learn more about everything that we have to offer at milibrary.org. For example, we have the fantastic author Obi Kaufman coming tomorrow with his new publication, The Deserts of California. That's tomorrow back in this space at 6 p.m. We have our fantastic members meeting coming up on December 7th and our holiday gathering on December 14th. We have a brand new program on Friday, December 8th, called Writers Read. It is our own writers here at Mechanics Institute reading their own works. And that's our very first time doing this kind of program. And we welcome everyone to come and support these incredible, vibrant, up-and-coming writers. With that, I'm very excited to welcome Corey Rosen. You know him, you love him, we all love him. Who doesn't love Corey Rosen? He's the best. The host with the most, the Moth host, Grand Slam show. You've seen him in every which way possible. I'm very excited to welcome Corey back for this wonderful partnership. And with that, please give a warm welcome to Corey Rosen.
All right, how's everybody doing? Thank you so much for coming out on a Wednesday night. There's apparently some BART traffic, some BART problems, so we may have some late arrivals to the show, but we will just welcome them when they come. I'm so happy to have you back. For those of you who are here for the first time, welcome. My name is Corey Rosen, and this is a monthly, I'm very honored to have been invited to this monthly residency here at the Mechanics Institute, where I put on typically on the, like today, the last Wednesday of every month, a storytelling program that features storytelling, sometimes stand-up comedy, different forms and variations of storytelling. And tonight is truly an exciting night for me because I have the great privilege and honor of having kind of invited some friends who are like-minded storytelling colleagues in the world of what we do, in the world of storytelling, to, as I said in the beginning when we were kind of setting up, we were here to blow the roof off of this place. And I was told, this is a very old building, please do not blow the roof off. It's definitely in need of replacing anyway. So we're gonna not blow the roof off, but give it up for Casey Clem, our resident DJ tonight. We have music. More exciting is that we have a very, very unique and special format. So I'm very privileged and proud to introduce my good friend, Frayne Masters. Give it up for Frayne Masters on Backfence PDX.
Hi. Thank you, Corey, so much for inviting me down to San Francisco to do this show. Very, very excited to be here.
Yeah, what I hope is that you sort of introduce the show, tell us what we're in for and all that stuff.
Is that what you hope?
That's what I was hoping. Yeah.
Right, I will do it then.
Yeah.
And just for Alyssa's introduction, I'm really excited to learn more about what's between chess club and writing. She's like, anything between those two things, I want to know all of those.
There's so many things in between, yeah.
Chess
yeah.
club and writing, every single point of interest.
Writing about chess is one of the things.
Yes.
Chess writing, chess related writing.
And chess jokes.
Test jokes, that's a thing. There's a test joke club. Is there a test joke club? And you know, there's actually a book club happening right in there. And I went in there and I was like, maybe the book club just wants to come to the show tonight. And then I turned to my left and I saw that there was also 40 people on Zoom. So I'm like, maybe not. So you want to just also have them come on Zoom. So,
right, but thank you for inviting them. It's good to invite everyone. This space is amazing, by the way.
Yeah.
This is like, I feel like I'm in a detective agency. So here's the deal. Backfence PDX Roulette, this is its 10th year, which is amazing to me, in my mind. So how it works is we have corralled four storytellers here tonight, and they don't know what story they're going to tell tonight. And that's where this wheel comes in. Because it looks like just eight innocent numbers on a wheel. Yes, it does. Thank you, Casey.
Looks like eight numbers. Yeah.
I know, I love it. No, please, please, that's amazing. I love it.
What's behind the numbers on the wheel? You feel those
mystery,
numbers wrong?
Oh, mystery. And intrigue and excitement is what's behind these numbers on his wheel. So each of these numbers represents a prompt. And the storytellers don't know what any of the prompts are behind these numbers. So they literally really don't know what story they're going to tell tonight. And so they're just going to take a slice from their life, about 5 to 7 minutes, and they're just going to spill it on stage for your entertainment. That's what's going to happen tonight. Yes, Quinn.
So give it up for the storytellers.
Yes, give it up for the storytellers. Raise your hand, and Quinn is part of the chess club here and also a writing group. Yes?
Yeah.
Yeah. Are you going to be participating in the event that Alyssa just talked about? The reading, reading, writer's reading thing?
I'm not sure.
Yes, you are. Quinn's going to participate, right?
Yes, all right. You decide you are. I hope you're not.
I'm making you do it, Quinn. I'm sorry. But I met you and I'm making you do it. But Quinn has decided to be our bell ringer for this evening.
Yeah.
And we're just gonna, she was on it. I mean, you're getting whatever service you need plus a good story from Quinn tonight. And we're gonna move right to that. So so that the storytellers, because they don't know what story they're telling, they get a bell at 5 minutes. It's just a gentle 5 minute ding from Quinn. Oh,
yeah.
That was pretty. That's a pretty 5 minute bell. That's really gorgeous, I feel like. Very like fairy like. But when they get a little further on, maybe six and a half minutes, they'll hear this. It's a little more terse. Oh, so much more terse.
Oh yeah. you can hear the subtlety in that.
I appreciate your subtlety in bell ringing, Quinn. And then maybe when we get to like 8 minutes, 7.5, 8 minutes, we might hear.
Yeah.
Yes, maybe not that much, but that was good.
That sounds like a shut up bell to me.
Yeah.
But that sounds like
there's a lot of urgency in that.
That's a
part. There's a lot of urgency in that. Absolutely.
The storytellers maybe then at that point would wrap up their story, conclude
yes.
the story.
Yes, absolutely. So one of the things is that so the storytellers' names are drawn at random. They also don't know what order they're going in this evening.
They'll be drawn like a deck of cards. They'll be picked.
Yes, they'll be picked from a deck of cards,
yes.
Which will be called out by you. And once the storyteller is picked, they have 5 minutes to go backstage and ruminate on their true 5 minute story and then come out and tell it.
Mm.
Right?
Yeah.
So the risk rises in the evening. Don't know what the prompt is, and then have to come backstage and then figure out what the story is after
yeah.
that. Yes, Quinn has a question. Yes.
Well, the prompt. Behind the number remain the same prompts throughout the evening.
Yes.
Well, yes.
Yes.
And every storyteller, so if a storyteller lands, like let's say one storyteller lands on one and then another storyteller lands on one, we'll have them spin again. So
yeah,
that's
we'll try to keep it to one story per prompt.
That's right, what
yeah.
he said. One story per
yeah.
prompt. Exactly.
Yeah.
And so with that, because they need 5 minutes to get prepared for that story, in the middle of our astounding introduction right now, we need to get the first storyteller
we should
on
do
stage.
That. We should do that.
So, Corey, will you do the honors of splaying those cards?
I sure will.
Like?
And will someone...
On the count of three. I'm going to go 3, 2, 1, and then call out a card. Here you go. 3, 2, 1.
Ace.
Ace.
I heard ace. I heard ace.
Loud and clear.
All right. The
very
ace.
Clear. Yes.
The ace is Beth Lissick.
Beth Lissick!
Beth is our ace.
Welcome back to the stage. She will be where Mike is standing between us is very sacred. That's why Corey and I are not using it. So Beth, if you can spin the wheel and come up with our first prompt, please.
All right, here we go.
Here we go. Woo-hoo.
That is a seven. That
number
is a seven.
So,
hey, Frank, before I read number seven, I just need to ask, what if the storyteller doesn't want the prompt? Is there
a good
way?
Question?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. So, Beth, thank you for being up here while we
play. Okay.
Okay. So, Beth, you have a chance to play or pass this prompt, okay? As does every storyteller. If you pass this prompt, another storyteller can steal it. And how do they do that? They just yell and raise their hand, and then they can steal it.
Yeah.
Now, if you pass and no one steals the prompt, we go into sudden death spin round, where the next prompt you spin, you have to take. So that means, like, if somebody steals it right now, the next time you come up, the next prompt you spin, you have to take it. Okay, does that make sense?
Yeah.
Does that make sense, everyone?
Yeah.
All right, excellent. So now, let us reveal prompt number seven, Corey.
All right, prompt number seven is... Gut-wrenching.
Now, audience, while Beth thinks about that,
gut-wrenching.
Count down with me, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, while Beth thinks about her prompt. Here we go.
5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Beth, will you play or pass gut-wrenching? I'll play.
Yay!
So backstage behind that door over there. And Beth will be back there for about 5 minutes to think it up her story.
Yeah.
While we continue on with this. So, what happens is at the end of the night, you all will have an opportunity to vote on your favorite storyteller. And voting is really anything you want tonight. Maybe you're in the mood for a story that has a lot of scary elements to it, or you need a sad story, or you need a story that's really funny or gross. I don't know what you need tonight, but you're going to vote for your favorite story. And the storyteller wins a gift.
Yep, there will be a gift for the storyteller that wins the most votes, as well as an audience member will win a prize. It is the holiday season, is it not? Yes. Who doesn't like to get prizes?
Prizes for everyone.
One of you will also win a prize. So there will be two prizes.
There will be two prizes.
Yes.
And you should have a voting sheets given out.
They were not.
They were not.
Should we give those out?
We should totally give
those Let's
out.
Let's do that. Okay,
yes.
So here are the voting sheets. The voting sheets don't actually have a name on them. They just have a place for your name to sign in your name, and then when we
Alyssa
them,
again, everyone, I had to get for Alyssa, who was amazing.
Yes. And so I think that the way it works is that when you do the voting, we'll basically have a basket per storyteller. We'll kind of collect a basket for Beth, a basket for David, a basket for Matt, and a basket for Harriet. We'll have one basket each.
And we'll line them up in the order that they told stories.
Yeah, and the forms conveniently have a place to put your name and email if you want to join our mailing list. So just in case you wanted to, there's also a place to do that. So we just one stop shopping at Backfence PDX.
That's right. And so just remember to put your name on the voting slip and not the name of the person you're voting for, because otherwise you won't win the glorious prize.
So that is your ballot.
Yes.
And this is a very secure. Dominion is going to be counting the ballot.
Yes.
There will
Right. There's a suitcased man standing outside right now that will be announcing that.
Yeah.
Yes. And so you'll do that. And then we will then, throughout the night, we're going to, pretty soon, I'm just going to reintroduce Quinn. And she's already done all the bell ringing stuff, so she'll do that part of it. We'll vote. And then we also need to get the second story.
That's its time.
So
you might say, wait a minute, we haven't even heard a story yet, but remember there's this 5-minute gap that we're building
in. Correct.
So what we're going to do right now is we're actually going to bring a second storyteller up to get their topic.
Get their topics, and then Beth will come out right
exactly.
after.
Exactly. So do you understand that mode? And then it'll be a lot smoother. So we're going to get the second storyteller. So they are going to now go backstage, when we bring out
that. It's pretty smooth.
That's pretty smooth. That's smooth,
right?
Right?
Smooth. All right.
Are there any questions? Was this clear?
Everybody get what's going on?
No, great.
We're good. Okay. Right. So we need to get
there's a question. There's one question in the second row.
We have a hand raised. Yes.
Exactly.
Both of those.
Yes. The question is this
the
vote
next
for the
show? We'll have a prompt because we have the audience in Portland fill it out, and then this show tonight is largely audience-based prompts from filling out this slip.
Yeah.
So yeah.
So on the slip, it has your name, your email, a suggestion for a prompt for a future show, not for tonight.
That Cora could use here, or I can use it in Portland.
Yeah.
Any of those things. So we're going to display those last three
Let's
cards.
Let's do it. We're going to pick a second
card
storyteller.
And on the count of three, somebody yell out a card.
Queen.
Very clear and concise, thank you.
Yeah.
All
right.
Okay. Playing with the Queen of Hearts.
All right.
Nobody
our Queen. Harriet Jernigan, everyone.
Harriet!
Jernigan.
Join us on stage to spin the game show wheel. Going to give it a nice, solid spin. Here we go. Keep clapping for Harriet as she spins. Oh, that's right. And it lands on eight.
Number eight. Okay, Harriet, are you ready?
Sequential prompts we're getting
yes,
tonight, Harriet.
Yes.
Seven
okay.
And eight.
Okay, here we go. Yeah. So,
audience, get ready to count down.
They're ready to count down.
After the prompt is revealed.
Harriet, your prompt is a sign from above.
Ooh, a sign from above. Well, Harriet thinks about that. Here we go.
Five, four. Three, two, one.
Harriet, will you play or pass a sign from above?
Yes! All right.
We have two players tonight. You know what that means? As Harriet makes her way backstage, it's time for our first storyteller to make their way to the stage. Please give a big, glorious, sweater-hugging round of applause. Hungering. If you're a moth, a hungering. Round of applause for our first storyteller of the evening, Beth Rosen.
I show up to work and my boss greets me in his underwear again. This has happened many times and I'm getting used to it. I try to just keep my eyes focused on his eyes. He opens the door to his apartment. I've never been inside the apartment. My boss is a surgeon at Mount Sinai in New York City who's been diagnosed with frontotemporal dementia at age 56. So there are a lot of things that he's not supposed to do. It affects your frontal and temporal lobes, all your decision making, all your impulse control is totally out the window. And the reason that I am hired to work with him mostly is just to keep him from stealing things, pushing people in the street when he gets accidentally touched. He's already been arrested for kicking a child and fleeing up the ramp at the Guggenheim Museum where he was tackled by the police. And so now he has a person like me, a minder, because he loves to go out and walk in New York City. He's from the city. He feels really good when he's out there walking, wearing an incredible outfit, maybe a salmon-colored sweater and yellow pants, and he has an great wardrobe, but now he's starting to break down a lot of barriers with me. And so he opens the door and he's in his underwear and I look and he holds out his wrists and he has cut his wrists. Not so much that he's bleeding profusely. He hasn't done a great job. They're very scratched up, but he's not in imminent danger. So I call my supervisor and she says, if he's okay, why don't you try to get him dressed and get him calm? But the thing with, he loves his apartment. If you're familiar with New York City, he's right near Lincoln Center. It's a gorgeous modern building. And I peeked into the door, but he usually comes out to greet me, and I say, I have to come inside, and he doesn't like anybody to touch him or touch his things, and he looks so distraught as if he hasn't been sleeping, and he steps back, and for the first time, he lets me into his apartment. And I sit down on the couch and he says, no, and he opens a roll of paper towels and he lays paper towels across the whole sofa and he says, you may sit now. So I'm sitting across from him and waiting to hear from his brother and sister. He doesn't have any, he's not married, he doesn't have any children. His brother takes care of all of his financial stuff, but there's been a rift in the family and some things that I don't know have happened and they're not on very good terms. So I call his brother and his brother doesn't answer his phone. I call his sister doesn't answer her phone. And so my supervisor is sending a nurse and she's on her way. And I say, why don't we get dressed? Why don't we go out and get a hamburger? And he loves hamburgers. That's all he eats is egg McMuffins and hamburgers. And I'm not joking. I was with him for a year and a half, and that is all he ate. So I said, let's go get a hamburger. And he's trying to put his clothes on, and the nurse comes, and he's very upset at seeing her. And I say, if we can just get him on the street and walking, maybe he'll be feeling better. And so she and I convince him to walk down the street, and he walks right into Mount Sinai. There's one on the upper west, east side. There's another branch on the upper west side. He walks right in and goes into the emergency room and just shows him his wrist. And so they take him away. And for the next 2 weeks, my job is to visit in the psychiatric ward at Mount Sinai, the very hospital where he worked. He has colleagues that will come and visit him. And it's so heartbreaking to see this. And while there, his brother decides that he needs 24/7 care now. So he needs to move from a one-bedroom apartment to a two-bedroom apartment. And there's a company in New York City that works with people who have dementia to try to recreate their exact physical space in a different space. These people are very wealthy. They have a lot of money, the Bill's family. And so they put all this money, give all this money to this company who I work with to try to move the apartment that he was in down the hall to a two-bedroom apartment. And amazingly, they found an apartment on the same floor. So on my days, I'm visiting him, and then I'm going to the apartment building, and we're taking pictures and trying to move everything. And we move something, we move everything down to the other apartment so that when he comes home, he can go to that apartment and we can stay with him. And he comes up the elevator on that first day back, and he starts going to his other apartment. And he knows all these places by rote memory now, and he doesn't have a lot of language. And I have to tell him, oh, no, this isn't your apartment. Your apartment's over here. And there's a lot of mind tricks you do when you're working with people with dementia, but there are some that don't feel so great. So for weeks, he goes to the other apartment. He's banging on the other apartment door. It's hard to keep him in his own apartment. And finally, he gets acclimated, and he never comes into the bedroom where I sleep at night or where all the caregivers stay. And one day, he opens up the door, and he walks in, and it's like those dreams you have where there's an extra part of your house that you didn't know you had or something, you know? And he looks around, and he's thinking, my God, this is crazy. Why does my apartment have another room to it? But he also has dementia, so he's thinking maybe it was always there and he didn't know. And it was horrifying to have to lie to him and pretend that this room was always there because he didn't like change. And so I had to, for the first time, lie to him in a way that felt devious. And I had to be adamant about it and say, no, the room has always been, I've always been in this room. We're here with you. We're here taking care of you. And this room is in your apartment. And it's not a different apartment at all.
Oh, wow.
Keep going for that realistic.
amazing.
That was indeed a gut-wrenching story, which was your prompt, which was incredible. And just Beth hosts a storytelling show that's been in San Francisco for how long now?
21 years.
21 years, called Porch Light Storytelling, and you're doing a show at the Sketch Fest, right?
Yeah, end of January.
End of January, Beth will be hosting with her partner Arlene a Porch Light Storytelling show at the end of January. So go check that out. It's incredible.
Where's the best place to find out? At Porch
yes.
Light or at Sketch Fest?
Sketch Fest or our Facebook page.
All right.
So check out Porch Light's Facebook page
yes.
or Sketch
Fest. Let's give it up again for Beth. That was an amazing start. Really like about the show is you don't know what the stories are going to be like. They're going to be deep and challenging. They're going to be just straight up funny. They'll be scary. They'll be all kinds of things. And I love it. That's amazing. So amazing. Okay, before we bring out
we should pick the third story.
We
got
to get the third
story. All right.
So
we have two cards. We have a king and a jack.
Jack.
Oh, yeah, okay, we're a solid jack from the audience.
Jack.
Also, I had many of those dreams with the extra rooms in the apartment. That is insane. That was like very, that struck a chord with me, and that's very real. Yeah.
Okay. All right, so our third storyteller, David Rodriguez.
David Rodriguez.
David Rodriguez. David Rodriguez will be in the Moth Grand Slam tomorrow night at the Castro Theater.
So,
for any of you who did not or could not get tickets to that sold out show, good, because this is better. He's going to give the better.
You get intimacy tonight.
Yes.
All right, here we go.
All right, number five.
So number five.
Number five, all right.
So, audience, get ready to count down with me while David thinks about what.
All right. The number five prompt is. Slippery slope.
Ooh, here we
slippery
go.
Slope.
Five,
four, three, two, one.
David, will you play or pass slippery slope?
Can I pass?
Pass.
I'll take it.
Matchy!
Where's Neil?
Matt, come on up on the stage. This is Matt Sheehy, my friend from Portland, Oregon. We're both here from Portland, Oregon. And Matt was steel slippery slope. Yeah.
Yes, I would like to steal slippery slope.
Amazing. So Matt will make his way into the secreted hallway to come up with his story, the secreted special hallway for this show that appears only for this show.
It's the hallway of secrets. That's
right,
where all secrets are.
Oh, let's give it up for Matt as he goes back to
the way for our sign from above.
Yes,
story.
We have a sign from above story coming to you from
Harriet Jernigan, everybody.
Harriet
give it up for Harriet Jernigan.
Harriet Jernigan making her way to the stage.
Everybody can hear me?
Yes!
It's 2012, and I am in a small town called Solingen in Germany, and I am in a bathroom texting with a friend in Davis, California. And I'm like, dude, I do not know how I am supposed to get out of this situation. And the situation is, I am sitting with the parents of the man that I am currently in love with. And it turns out that the man that I'm currently in love with is absolutely fucking bonkers. One of the things that I like about him is that he's a radiologist. He used to be a surgeon. He's sort of like rocket science smart. And we've had this sort of up and down relationship going on for 3 years. And we are at this point now where it's sort of a do or die kind of situation. And he has the week off while I'm visiting, and he says, well, what do you want to do? And I said, well, I'd like to go see some knives and some swords in Solingen because it has a huge museum there. And he was like, oh, by the way, my parents live there, so we should go visit them. And I'm like, I have heard about your parents. This is not an exciting prospect. And I'm like, okay, fine, right? If I'm going to be with the man, right, got to be with the family. And we go to Solingen. He is sweating the entire time that we are driving to Solingen, like sweating buckets, right? He's also wearing the suit that he usually wears to work. And I'm like, why are you wearing a suit when you have time off? And he's like, because this is what my parents say a real doctor looks like. And I'm like, oh my God. And his mother is a former pâtissière, so she is like this hardcore baker, and I am actually also a professional baker. So I like put these cookies together like perfect, like roll them out, same weight, everything, make them perfectly circular, put them into a tin, take them, and I'm like, this will be my peace offering to this insane family. They're all high performers, future prodigies if not past, and they are sort of like expecting something. I don't know what they're expecting. He's already sort of like boosted me in sort of a social media kind of way. And so we get to the house, and the father is there. The mother is not there. The mother is there, and she's just had a hip surgery. And Andy, the guy, he's like, yeah, I had to tip all the nurses in the hospital just to thank them for putting up with the mother, right? And she's come out, and she's on a walker, and she's got all this stuff going on. And then this is literally what happens, is she opens the door, and she says, oh, it's so good to see you. Your father is at the grocery store, and I know he's going to mess it up because he never goes to the grocery. And she just starts into this litany of complaints about the father. And I'm like, wow, this is getting off to a really good start. So then he shows up, and he's got like this huge cart of shopping and everything. And she's like, oh, well, you got this wrong, you got that wrong, you got this wrong. And I'm like, this is not going to go well. And I sort of put the tin down, and they're like, oh my God. And she opens them, and she's like, oh, these are beautiful. And I'm like, yes, this is happening. This is going to work. And then the father, the mother, Andy, and I sit down at a table. And it's the father and Andy across, and then it's me and the mother across. And what you start to see is sort of this, like, war of intellect happening, where the father sort of has like this cannon of a question and he lobs it over the table. And basically it's sort of like, I went to the market and I saw strawberries. What do you think of strawberries? And like throws it over to Andy. And then Andy's like, well, I have a complete and total dissertation about strawberries that was started in 1780. And I'm like, oh my God, what's happening? And then the mother is like, no, I just, so there's this whole weird war going on at this table. And I'm like, I don't know. And so I get up, I go to the bathroom, and I start texting this friend who knows about Andy, and I'm just like, what do I do? And he's like, what's the tenor of the conversation? I'm like, they're talking about things that are so obscure that even with my education, I cannot keep up. And he's like, just be agreeable and just be, you know, just be chill about it. I'm like, you cannot be chill about it because this woman is literally sniping at the husband the entire time. The father is throwing out these sort of LSAT, LSAT questions to the son. And then every once in a while they come back and they're like, so what do you think? And I'm like, I think nothing. I'm just gonna sit here and try to be a pretty face and think nothing. Cookies, right? And so I'm taking this break in the bathroom, and it turns out I'm gone for 5 minutes, and I'm like, okay, they're gonna start thinking that I'm destroying their bathroom or something, so I go back. And we end up like sitting there a little bit longer, and then Andy's still wearing the jacket. He's already gone through like 2 liters of water. He's still sweating buckets, and I'm like, this is not a good scene. And at some point, the mother says, well, we really need to sit down and talk to the insurance company because they obviously screwed up my surgery. I'm not healing quickly enough, and you know, there's obviously a problem. And the doctor, Andy, he's like, no, everything's fine. I've looked at your chart. I've looked at everything. It's totally fine. And she says, no, there's obviously a problem. And he slams his fist on the table and he says, I have told you there is not a problem. And then she looks at him and says, well, obviously you're wrong. There's obviously a problem. We'll have to write the insurance company. I want my money back. And the father is sort of like sitting there. And by the way, did I mention that the father's deepest show of affection to his son was to shake his hand when they showed up? Like, this is a family that does not have feelings, they have degrees. And there is such a lack of like true authentic emotion going on that it's just sort of like really uncomfortable to be there. And he has this discussion and says, no, we're not talking to the insurance company. And she's like, no, no, we'll talk about it. And I'm like, this is, I cannot be a part of this family. But I'm thinking, like, I really love Andy, and I really think that he could use some support with the family and everything. And then right before we leave, right, the father gives Andy a hug, and I'm like, well, maybe I have been like a bridge to something good here, right? And then the mother looks at me, and she says, it's so nice to have fresh blood in the house. And I was like, ooh, that is, ooh. So I've got this sign, this is not going to work, right? But do I pay attention to the sign? No, of course not. I like keep going. And then we actually have a conversation on the way home. And he says, while you were in the bathroom, my parents said that you are the one and that I should just go ahead and marry you. And I was like, well, this relationship is over. There is no dude who's ever going to be like totally into your mother and your father said, go ahead and marry this one, right? But I have to say, even though I got this sign from above that this is never going to work, we actually sort of kept going for another year and a half. And then he broke up with me at that bookstore in New York. I can't remember what it's called, Strand, right? And that's where I lost my protégés and then like walked home from Wall Street. It was just a terrible time. But I will say that I'm glad that I at least had that exposure to his family to go, you know what, the loss is okay.
Very good, everybody.
Awesome, Harriet.
Amazing.
Great story.
So good. Harriet, by the way, teaches writing and rhetoric. She's affiliated with the Stanford Storytelling Project. And
yes.
She just started her own storytelling series called First Person, which goes live in January. Yes.
Amazing.
Yes. Is there any info that people that are listening or watching?
Talk to me, and I'll give you the email for more information.
Perfect. Perfect.
Talk to
Harriet
about
her own storytelling series.
That's amazing. And also, we'll play the slideshow again at the end, which will have your Instagram on it, and you can follow that as well.
Yeah.
That was incredible.
So
wow.
Good. So
what
good.
A good night so far.
So good.
Oh,
I mean,
that's
signing
great.
Above.
This is so great.
Gut-wrenching.
Yes.
Two stories to go, but before
yes.
we bring up our third storyteller,
we have a mystery fourth person.
Yeah. Which
we don't have any idea who they
pick?
Are.
Should we pick the king? No, it's
like,
so,
yeah.
That was that,
king so. So remember, this is the sudden death spin. So David, whatever you spin next.
Actually,
it's a sudden
story.
Oh, too late. Too late. But here you go. Give it a spin.
Right.
Yeah, yes. I just
have
to say yeah. Okay.
This is a sudden death. Must take.
I don't have any idea what
it's gonna be. It's
number six.
It's on, yeah, six.
Six.
Right on the line.
You're
in
the high
right?
numbers tonight.
Number six. Okay, number six.
Yes.
Your must take. So there'll be no countdown.
There's no countdown. This is just it.
Best intentions.
Ooh.
Best intentions.
All right.
Best
give it up for David.
Go
to the end. We are final storyteller of the evening. And let's give it up for your penultimate storyteller of the evening. The wonderful, the marvelous Matt G.
Yes, the slippery silk story.
So there he was, standing in front of the McDonald's in my hometown. It was Bob Saget. I am 16 years old. We're in Juneau, Alaska, the town that I grew up in. One of the most like exciting things that can happen when you grow up in a remote place like Juneau, Alaska, is to have a famous person come to town. And you know, there's Bob Saget, and it's not just Bob Saget. Next to him is Candace Cameron. The two of them are filming a what do they call it, like an away episode of Full House on a cruise ship that just stopped in Juneau's a port. So both Bob Saget and Candace Cameron are standing there. Now, you know, it was like, whoa, famous person, whoa. I was with my friends. I was with this little, you know, group of like angry punk rock kids. We were like these punk rock Alaskan kids, you know, like wearing like parkas, but we had spike bracelets and stuff. My parents were getting a divorce. I was really mad about life. My favorite artist of all time at the time was Ian MacKaye, the singer of Minor Threat. He was like a pure artist. You know, he had a record label. He was just like this pure artist. And I was like, people should be pure artists. And there's Bob Saget. And you're like, we're all talking about him. I'm like, man, Bob Saget, he's so dumb. We've seen America's Funniest Home Videos. His jokes are so stupid. And I was like, somebody should tell him that his jokes are so stupid. And my friend's like, yeah, you should go tell him that his jokes are so stupid. And I was like, you know what? I'm good. So I walked up to Bob Saget on the corner in Juneau, Alaska. And I said, hey, are you Bob Saget? He's like, oh, yes, I am. And I said, do you write your own jokes for America's Funniest Home Videos? And he goes, oh, I don't even want to know what you're going to say. And I said, because they suck. Yeah, I said that. This angry 16-year-old teenage boy said that to Bob Saget. All my friends laughed. Huge repeat reaction. I had one. You know, my mind's like, this is amazing. Fast forward probably 10 years. I started doing a little bit of acting, kind of accidentally. A friend had a film, put me in it. I thought it was really fun. I did another one. You know, it was just sort of word of mouth thing. And then somebody was like, hey, my friend's an agent. I can introduce you to them. Maybe you could like do some ads. I did a commercial. I like just sort of on a whim, and I like got paid to do an acting gig. And I was like, whoa, $1,500 was a ton of money to do that. And I was like, what if I could just keep acting, you know? So I like talked to this agent. He was like, oh yeah, you know, get a headshot, you know, we can maybe think about this. And I was like, okay. So I got these headshots, and then he like started sending them out, you know. And then, you know, I got like, I remember I had a Dunkin' Donuts ad that I went and auditioned for, and I was like, I just felt so like such an idiot in this audition. That's a whole other story, but it was absolutely humiliating, just like standing there, just feeling like a naked person with people like throwing darts at me, you know. And so I remember like later that day, I'm like talking to my girlfriend at the time. Her name was Aaliyah, and I was like, you know, this is like rough. I can see how like you really want to do some art, and then you also want to get paid. And then you're like tempted to do this stuff that makes you look like an idiot. I'm just thinking like, what if I do this Dunkin' Donuts ad? Like people are gonna see that and think that I'm an idiot. And like, you know, or just whatever, you know? Like, not that I'm an idiot, but it's just like, oh, there's just another one of those idiots on TV, like doing the dumb thing or whatever. You know, still kind of, you know, I hadn't lost all my teenage angst at this point. And then I ended up telling her the Bob Saget story. And Aaliyah was like, you realize that your karma is fucked, right? Like, that's what's going on here. And I was like, my karma's fucked. She's like, yes, it's fucked. And I was like, well, what do I do about my karma being fucked? And she's like, you gotta write him a letter. I was like, all right. So I put pen to paper, and I write Bob Saget an apology letter where I explain everything. You know, because I'm like, Bob Saget's probably, you know, he probably remembers that. And then he had some kid walk up to him and tell him that he sucks. Like, he's carrying that around with him, of course. I gotta fix this. So, like, I'm like, dear Bob Saget, I'm an angry teenager. My parents are getting divorced. Ian MacKay, blah, blah, blah. And then, I'm sorry. Put it in a letter. Send it off. And I'm like, okay, well, hopefully my karma is clean. A month later, an envelope arrives in the mail. And I'm like, whoa, Aaliyah, look, there's an envelope here, and it says Bob Saget in the return address. And she's like, oh my God, you know? And it's like 8.5 by 11. And I open the envelope, and I pull out a 8.5 by 11 glossy headshot of Bob Saget. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And then down the bottom, he's written something. Oh my God, he's read my letter, and he wrote me back, you know, and it says, hey man, Bob. That's it.
Yeah. You know, I think there was a lot of subtext in that letter.
There was a lot of subtext in that letter.
It just said, hey man, Bob, but what do you think it really said underneath that?
I think that, you know, Bob Saget was known for having kind of a filthy mouth.
He was.
He was on, and he was also known for being very generous in lots of things.
Yeah.
But I think it was a little fuck you. Right?
Definitely. Hey man was coded. That was, yeah.
Definitely a fuck you.
That was fuck you.
But I feel like both of your karmas were actually clear.
Yeah.
He said fuck you to him.
Yeah.
He said fuck you to you. Now there's no fucks anymore.
And you've never done anything foolish since?
No.
Yeah.
Never. Let's give it up for all three stories.
Yes. Woo! Is there one other people? Is there anything we should plug for you? Is Lost Land Urbane going on tour, anything happening with your band and
your solo show and everything?
Not soon. Nothing that I can point you to, but there will be a new record next year.
Okay.
Awesome.
All right.
Yeah. And Aberdeen's a beautiful record. So please check that out.
All right. Check that out. Back out. Super.
Yeah, absolutely. And just a reminder, we will do a little
recap of all
four stories before you come up and vote. And of course, our fabulous DJ, Casey Clem, while you're voting, will play music during that. Yes, please give him a hand. Yes, absolutely. We'll play music while you're voting. So just keep thinking about, like, what story did I need tonight that I need to vote on and win a fabulous prize, possibly. All right, great. So
It's time. It's time for our best intentions, our fourth out of four stories.
Here we go.
Please welcome David Rodriguez.
I was on vacation in New Mexico, and my wife and I were living it up in one room, and my dad and my stepmom had like a different room. And at about 6 in the morning, I heard this big banging on the door, and I was naked. So my wife opened the door with my dad, and I knew, because, you know, you spend decades with somebody. I'd never had a moment like this before, but I knew that someone had died. And I was just thinking, please don't let it be my brother. But it was my little brother. And the irony is that I was in New Mexico because I was worried my dad was going to die. He was getting old in age. And his family's from New Mexico. It was like this trip, and I was consciously on this trip because I was like, Dad's probably gonna die. Let's get out there while you can still move. And you know, when someone you love dies, you become like a professional griever, and everyone, like, you can see them preparing before they come talk to you. You can see them like getting ready. I'm gonna say the perfect thing. I'm gonna nail it. And you can see, and they're like, it's like they're going to sign the autograph of their, get an autograph from their favorite baseball player or something. And you have to give what little energy you have, like comforting them about the advice they just gave you, even though you don't have any energy. And the most common advice I got was to look for signs. Look for signs. You know, my mother's a butterfly, my grandpa's a gust of wind, this, that. But I'm like a very cynical person. I don't believe in that stuff, but I started to really want to, you know? And I was walking down the street one day and this bird landed right in front of me, this big giant bird, and it just stood there. We were in this, like, you know, 12 o'clock high noon standoff. And I started thinking, is that bird my brother? You know, and I called my friend Jen, who was like big sign believer, and she's like, I got the bird finder up, I'm gonna hook you up. Send me a picture of that bird. So I sent a picture of the bird, and I was just kind of in my mind, I was like, if it's a rare bird, it's my brother. You know, I'm not a big birder. And I was like, is it like a really uncommon bird? She's like, as soon as I heard that, I was like, I'm done with this common ass bird. I cannot believe God is dead. Like, no, like, there's no signs. And I, like, chided myself for even for a second believing that this stupid bird was my brother. But the next time I kind of thought that I got a sign, I was sitting at in my apartment, and I was talking to the coroner, and he was about to tell me the results of the toxicology report. And I had spent like a month trying to convince myself that the results of this report did not matter. how he died. And I was preparing myself for it to not matter, but then when I found out that he died sober, I was so proud of him. And I found out that it did actually matter to me. And right at that moment, Google Home chose to shuffle in Alive by Sia. Notwithstanding the fact that she sings I'm Alive over and over again in the chorus, but that was my brother's sobriety anthem, because he would have told you within 5 seconds of meeting you that Sia was a recovered alcoholic. And he died based on his tabs listening to her greatest hits. And that was a song I had actively been avoiding listening to. And I started to feel myself believe that signs were real, but then a bigger part of me pushed back and was like, this is bullshit. If my brother could leave a sign, the kind of sign he would leave is like an actual sign. Like, I would be walking down the street and I would see what I thought was a homeless person's sign, but then I would see his handwriting and it would say, hey Dave, guess what? We can send signs from heaven. The way it works is every day an angel comes to visit you and asks you what kind of sign you live. Want to leave. Most people say behavior of cat or cloud, but I was like, an actual sign? And they're like, sure, what do you want it to say? I guess there's a word limit. Bye. Because, like, even if signs are real, like, what is, like, a butterfly or like, a song compared to the life of my brother? Like, who cares about a sign? He was a beautiful man. He had these like genetically improbable gray blue eyes, even though he's Mexican like me, and he would use them to listen with such intensity to people, and he had no time for small talk. And he had dropped out of his program, PhD program at Berkeley, because of his addiction, but he had put his hat in hand and gone back and re-enrolled, and he was slated to begin in the fall, and he deserved to walk on that stage, and he deserved to see that he'd become an inspiration to other addicts, since he was actually in his longest period of sobriety ever. And this was the state of mind I was in the morning of his funeral. I was angry, and I was supposed to give the eulogy, and I'm supposed to be this big storyteller or whatever, and people were like, you're gonna go last, David, I don't wanna go after you. But I had no ideas. And I had 30 minutes, I was in my suit, and I was frantically running around my apartment looking for a notebook. And I was so mad at myself, because I have so many, but I couldn't find one. And then I saw this composition book underneath a stack of books, and I picked it up, and I opened it up, and I saw my brother's handwriting. He must have written in it when he was crashing on my couch after a relapse from like a year and a half ago. And it was a poem. And it was called A Cold Fall Night. And it read, I'm late. My second ever open water swim at aquatic park. He crossed out the words, I'm nervous, and replaced it with, you'll never be alone. Buoyant. Even when nobody's around the boat. I guess I like decided to just stay neutral on signs. I don't believe them or not believe in them. But I go to his grave often. And sometimes I talk to him. I don't make small talk. I just talk to him like about my life in the present. But then other times I close my eyes and I listen to the birds, and I feel the sun, and my thoughts fade away until I'm buoyant, even though nobody else is around. Thank you. Thank you for being here, everybody.
Stories we had this evening, and so we're gonna put four baskets up here.
This is what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna put the picture of the storyteller in the basket. How about
that?
That
is very smart. And Alyssa, like again, a hand for Alyssa.
Like,
and I would also like give it up again for Quinn, our bell ringer this evening, who's an amazing guy, and also for our DJ Casey Plum. Great. And the bar staff here at the Cannabis Institute.
have, first of all, we have Beth Lissick, who, they go here, right here, right on the front of the stage. Yeah. First, our first storyteller was Beth Lissick. That one? That's correct. Very good. And Beth told a story of being a dementia caregiver, as you remember. The first doctor story of the evening.
They're recreating the room and
yes. Oh my god, and having to lie about the second room with the heart.
Yeah. Second story, Harriet Jernigan,
yes.
About Germany, her German boyfriend, and his crazy family. Crazy, brilliant, crazy, all the crazies. Beautiful, craziness.
Yes. So there's Harriet, is the second one. And then we have Matt Sheehy with his Alaska story, and Bob Saget.
Bob Saget Adventure.
Of course.
Yes.
And writing a letter to Bob Saget.
Yep.
Just a universal fuck you, which we always like to hear about. Yep. Okay.
Yep.
And then we have David, who you just
heard. That hilarious story.
Lots of signs from above, everywhere. David Rodriguez at the end. So we're going to just take like a few minutes. You have your voting slips. They are again in order.
Yep.
And then we'll call all the storytellers back on stage. It will announce the winning storyteller, the winning audience members. And then we're going to wrap up this night. But here we go. And Casey's going to play some music while you vote. And remember, no pushing, no shoving, just a very cordial voting slip.
Yes. Put your slip in the basket with the storyteller that you want to work for.
Thank you.
Okay, Casey, so let's get all of our storytellers kind of in front of the stage. That includes room for everybody, but like right in front of the stage for David, Matt, Harriet, Beth. Where is Matt? Go is Matt so we're gonna give away. There he is. Okay, great. So let's give a round of applause to all of our storytellers. Amazing. Okay, so this was a very, very close call. Everybody got a lot of votes. Just a couple votes between the winner and the second person. But there was a winner this evening. And say it with me, Corey. Oh, do you have your microphone? Say it. Say it with me. Ready? One, two, three.
David Rodriguez!
And David will draw a name, and I'll read it.
Before he reads it, should we give David his prize?
No, we'll give him both the same time. We'll give him both the same time. Here we go. I got it. Here we go. Thank you, David. No, it's okay.
Audience winner
is drum roll, please. That's right. Oh, I like how everyone did that. We all know that cue, don't we? Susan
Greenhow!
Susan Greenhow, what do you win? This is like, I hope you went to a white elephant party because you've got the gift for it.
Yes, exactly.
Here it is. Trader Rose has many treats, but everyone's favorite is
Gin Amarena Cherries with Scotch.
Susan. Yes! Cherries for everyone, most especially Susan. All right, and David.
David gets a cold
disco nutcracker.
Disco nutcracker.
Yes!
I am your 2023 Christmas what? Nutcracker?
You
remember the tracks was
2022.
Give it up one more time for the cast of your cast.
Thank you so much for being so welcome to us from Portland for Backfence PDX, most especially Corey for inviting our show down here.
Thank you, Corey.
And also to the Cat Institute and the bartenders, get the well on your way out. And I hope you all have a really great holiday season. Quinn, Casey Clem, Corey, all of our storytellers, bartenders, thank you so much. Have a great night.
Yes. And a quick reminder, we're doing this again December 20th. So not this exact format. It is a different show, but storytelling December 20th. So tickets are currently available. So do not delay and spread the word. We would love to have a packed house for the holidays. Thank you all so much. Good night, everyone.